Thank you for having me today. I appreciate the introduction. It's a warm-up for my retirement that's coming in May after 30 years. So interesting to hear it all encapsulated in 2 minutes. And I will say that Europe does exist. Are there any questions? Because that shortens my presentation. No, it exists, but there are a lot of issues, and it's a terrible time to talk about foreign policy today, and terrible because there's so much going on in terms of chaos and turmoil. We have a new administration that's been in office less than a month, so it's hard to stand up here, and when I was putting the presentation together, there's so much going on, but at the same time, it's a terribly good time to be talking about it because no one can hold me accountable in a month or two as to what I say. And that's the way it is traditionally anyway. But it's terribly good because there is so much going on. It's interesting, and you hear both sides. It's terrible what's happening. It's good what's happening. It's an opportunity. It's not an opportunity. And I think that there's a little bit of both. And when I was asked to do this presentation, I thought, okay, who's my audience? And what's the best way to get to them? So I decided to go with this. Yes, I do remember Johnny Carson and did watch him into my 20s, early 20s, but yes. But when I took that Great Decisions briefing book and put it to my head, all I came up with were a lot of prognostications that might be appropriate for late night TV. And I decided, okay, that's not the right way to go. I'm going to have to really look into this and see where I think things are going. And I think what I'm going to present today, I'm not going to tell you what the future of Europe is. I'll leave that to you to decide, because really, it's impossible to predict the future. And we've known that. I was an Intel analyst. We were told, you know, you don't predict the future. You look at trends, you look at what's going on, you make your best analytical guess as to what's happening based on logic and facts, and present it that way. And then, as everyone knows, chance, an unexpected event, something happens that changes how we have projected the future or looked at the future. But we have a foundation that we're starting from today, and that's the Great Decisions briefing book. And what I want to start with, because as I read the article, it reinforced to me an issue that I have when we talk about Europe. And that issue is, what is Europe? We start our European class here, our European Regional Studies, with our first lesson, an introduction to Europe, talking about what is Europe. We can't define Europe. It's very difficult. Because you look at it, is it a geographic boundary? If so, how far east does Europe go? Is it a political institution like the European Union? Because sometimes people conflate European Union with European when there's only 28 members in the European Union. Far more countries within Europe when you look at it bigger. Is it a security alliance like NATO? Same thing, another 28 countries there. The two organizations, you know, they don't really match up. So let's take a look at some of those institutions and we'll see, here we have the European Union. You can look at those 28 countries and they make sense. Say, okay, all right, I can see how those countries are part of the European Union, but there's some that are conspicuously absent. And Great Britain, or UK, when they leave, they're not going to be part of the European Union. Does that make them less European? So where do we go from here? We can't use the European Union to say that it's European because it's made up of European countries, but it's not necessarily representative of the whole of Europe. And then you have the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO. Okay, can we define it that way? There's some overlap, 22 countries that are the same, but there are some countries from Europe that are not part of the European Union. A lot of people question, is Turkey really part of Europe or is it not? It's been an age-old question. It's at the crossroads of two continents. And so do we really think that Turkey is part of Europe? So far, the European Union hasn't included them formally. But that's not necessarily because of geographic issues, that's because of some political issues. But then there's more, because then we have the Partnership for Peace. But wait a minute, Turkmenistan, is that part of Europe? Are we getting out into Central Asia, or are we still part of Europe? Why is this part of a European security organization? And the European, or the Euro-Atlantic Partnership Council, which encapsulates all of those countries except for Cyprus. Why is Cyprus not in there? Let's go back to Turkey and relate it back to the Turkish occupation of the northern part of Cyprus and the Greeks' relationship with the Turks that kind of keeps the Turks on the outside. That same relationship keeps Cyprus out of Europe. But then again, is Cyprus part of Europe or is it part of the Middle East? Where does Cyprus belong? Now, that's not just it, because then we have the whole Organization for Security Cooperation in Europe. 50 countries. Oh, and by the way, look, we added in the Holy See. We added in Liechtenstein, some of these smaller places. So it's really hard to say, what is Europe? And I think, personally, when I read the article, and I look at other things related to Europe, one of the first questions I said, which Europe are they talking about? Are they talking the Europe that represents the economic union? Are they talking about the Europe that is the military security arm of it? Or are they talking about this group that gets together and talks about issues and tries to find usually non-military ways to solve problems? So I leave you with that because it shows that there are different ways to look at Europe. And that adds to some of the problem. Because as you get into issues of governance and you get into issues of economic union, these things have to come into consideration. Neither the European Union nor NATO can ignore the other when they're making decisions. They're all interconnected. And then up here, you have Kosovo, which is right now not recognized by everyone as a country. The military is not a military, it's a security organization. So it's somewhere between a police force and a military. Yet we do have Kosovars who come to the Army War College as students. So Kosovo is on the outside of the whole thing. And where's that going? But let's get into the meat of the discussion here. So the first four bullets up there you see, those are the key points from the article that was associated with our presentation today. And Dr. Moffatt has been doing this for decades. He's gone far deeper into this than I have. And he probably knows all the key actors by first name. He probably goes to meetings and sits in meetings with them. And I agree with most of what he says. I think that his conclusions are logical, but there are some things in there that I don't agree with or things that I think need to be explained. And so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna talk down this slide a little bit, but then I'm gonna focus on those four points. So I'm going to skip those four points, those challenges that he identified, and he may not consider them existential. But there's three things. We had a speaker here in December. That speaker said there were three things that have shaken the European Union, not so much Europeans, but the European Union. One is the belief that European integration was unstoppable, irreversible, and yet we have Brexit. There was a belief that borders were coming down and that countries, the free flow of goods and people was not going to be stopped. But then we were faced by migration and we're faced by terrorism, and suddenly those things are questioned and walls are going up. And then the third one was a Europe that was whole and free, where the military arm of power for a government was in the decline. Because these countries in Europe, were living together in peace. But what happens out in Ukraine? There's an annexation of Crimea and activity in eastern Ukraine that then suddenly kind of shakes that thought that maybe we're not as secure as we think. And that's rattled throughout. I think those questions are important as we look at those, or those three comments were really important as we look at these bullets here. Let's take a look at the pillars of European security and defense policy, because it's important to understand where the European Union is going. And if you look, the implementation, these are three things that Federica Mogherini, the head of the foreign and security policy, she's basically the, I won't call her the Secretary of Defense because she's not, or Minister of Defense. It's a combination. Kind of a vice presidential position in the European Union. But she's the one who speaks on behalf of security and defense policy. And she identified three pillars recently, just a couple months ago in December, I think it was. So their global strategy, the European Union starting to develop strategy, and not just a strategy within Europe, but global. They're starting to realize that, hey, you know, with economic power comes other responsibilities. And in order to reinforce us as an institution, because I think it's important to understand, while they have elements of governance and they have elected officials, it's an institution, not a government. And it's a strange combination that really creates a little bit of confusion, but also causes some problems in terms of what countries think about the European Union and what its role is. So as we look at this and we look at the global strategy for foreign security policy, the European Union is realizing that they are expanding their responsibilities. The second one, the declaration of the EU and NATO back in Warsaw, greater integration, and I'll talk about that a little bit more because to me that's critical. And I might say a few things, and I think it's important to understand that what I'm going to say today is my opinion. It's not the War College, it's not the AHEC, it's not the Great Decisions Program. This is my own opinion of the way I think, sir. And some of it, I don't maybe necessarily believe 100%, but in an effort to kind of think a little bit more innovatively in a way that is not traditional, I may say a few things that you'll shake your head at or that you'll question, and I appreciate that. I don't believe it 100%, but it's kind of what I believe to be a trend. But that declaration between the EU and NATO is amazing how much cooperation there is between the two now. The European Union, which kind of by us on this side of the Atlantic has been dismissed as a military organization, is actually starting to grow stronger militarily. And in that regard, in an effort to avoid redundancy with NATO, there's greater cooperation with NATO in an effort to leverage NATO. And then the last part, which is the European Defense Action Plan and the intent to develop a European army of sorts. So those are the three pillars, and those are pretty significant today for the European Union. It's putting a little bit more teeth to the organization. So, you know, we talk about elements of power here, diplomatic, informational, military, and economic. Well, the EU is known for three of those, but they're not known for military, and I don't think there's anyone who fears the EU military or its capability. And it's not intended to be. Even as it evolves, it's not intended to be one that strikes fear into the hearts of their enemies, but it is one that has to be there in order to respond to crises. So those are three pillars that I think important as we go forward to understand that the EU is moving forward militarily with an effort to reinforce their own security in areas other than economic. Institutional improvements. So this long title right here, the High Representative for Security and Defense Policy, that's Federica Mogherini. And she was here. She was one of the first visitors to see President Trump in January when he took over. And I wouldn't doubt if it was because of his rhetoric about the European Union is disintegrating, the European Union is going away, they are our competitor, not necessarily someone that we are allied with. I don't doubt that it's also got to do with military cooperation and so many other things that are going on. But she was one of the first people to come talk to the president, the new president. And I think that's significant. Today started the Munich Security Conference. Secretary Mattis spoke this morning. Prime Minister Merkel will speak tomorrow. All of these people are going to be talking, which is another reason why it's terrible and terribly exciting to be talking today, because they can be on Twitter right now changing everything. Everything that I say just got thrown out the window. But I think that's not the case. I think that some of the things that I'll say will remain relevant even after they speak. The EU Foreign Service, it's a quasi-foreign service because it's not a government, it's not a, they don't have a Ministry of Foreign Affairs or a Department of State like we do. But this is a close equivalent. They do have some professionals, but a lot of them are seconded from the nations that are members. So one of our speakers that came to talk to us, he is a German, basically foreign service officer, what we would call foreign service officer, who has seconded to Washington, D.C., to the EU delegation in Washington. And that's significant because now we have diplomatic outreach. So they don't have embassies, they have these delegations around the world, but they are engaged on the informational side, the diplomatic side, and they have people representing the economic side and all of that. So this European External Action Service is an important arm of the European Union that is growing and getting stronger and more capable to reinforce those other elements of power. And then these other evolutionary, what I will call evolutionary changes, we talked about, does the EU really represent Europe? And I'll leave that for you to decide because we've already talked about the different organizations that are part of Europe, different nations and so on. Expansion and contraction, I'll talk a little bit about that later too, because expansion is part of the EU mandate. It's trying to bring in other nations in Europe into the European Union. But at the same time, you have Brexit and potentially other nations who are considering the alternative, that maybe integration is not the best solution. Maybe my voice is not being heard the way I would like it to be heard. Or maybe my national interests don't match up with the European Union. So you have an organization that's expanding and contracting at the same time, and how do you deal with that? And I think that even the European Union is struggling with that right now as they wait for the UK to activate their Article 50 declaration that they want to leave. But until that happens, I think the effort right now is to maintain them together. And then the European Neighborhood Policy, which is an effort to go beyond the borders of Europe into the Middle East and Africa to help other countries become more stable, more economically stable. But there's a lot of people who criticize that right now, saying it was largely ineffective, that it's failed. The chaos of North Africa and the Middle East along the Levant has created problems that the EU cannot surmount. The EU hasn't given up completely. They've kind of put some things on hold. But the neighborhood policy maybe is a bridge too far for them. Maybe they need to step back from the neighborhood policy, maintain the good relations, but the neighborhood policy is in question right now. I think that they have a lot of internal problems that they need to consider, that they need to think about before they continue to focus externally. So let's go back to the top four issues there of the geopolitical crisis, the democratic governance, the migration, and the euro crisis. All of those in the article seemed to be surmountable. The only one that was questionable was the economic crisis. Well, I think that it's more than the economic crisis that should be troubling to the European Union, and I will discuss that more. I think the migration crisis is a serious issue that can't be overlooked. It's an issue that stokes feelings that within people, individuals, within countries, sovereign countries, that are members of the EU and other organizations. And ignoring that individual level, I think, can become a problem if we try to brush over it as a large organization. And I'll talk about that in a minute. So the geopolitical crisis. Let's start with the United States. The election of Donald Trump is troubling to a lot of European countries, the European Union, NATO allies. Secretary Mattis this morning reaffirmed the U.S. commitment, citing the president's commitment to NATO. But at the same time, he reiterated something that presidents for probably three or four decades have been saying. We kind of focus it just on the last few years, but you can go back 30 years, some cases maybe even 40. But presidents have always said, the Europeans need to carry more of their weight within the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, that the U.S. is doing too much. And since the end of the Cold War, that has become even more of a mantra here in the U.S. And with President Trump, his feeling is, okay, the number that everyone throws out there is the U.S. pays 72% of the NATO budget. Now, it's a really hard number. I was talking to someone over at NATO earlier this week. He said that 72% is a generally accepted number, but there are so many different ways that people pay for things or nations pay for things that it's a fungible number. But he said generally accepted 72% at its face value. So 72%, that's a lot of money when you consider that there's 27 other countries that are in there. And how is that distributed? And not just 27 other countries, but you have some of the strongest economies in the world in there. You have the UK, you have Germany, you have France, very wealthy countries that should be able to meet that 2% criteria that very few countries have met. And while they say that they have it as an objective, it's very difficult to balance the rest of a national budget to meet that 2%. Even we, if we had to increase from, I think we're about 3.8%, if we had to increase to 4%, where would that come from? And we may be struggling with that right now. I don't know what the numbers are that we're trying to get to right now. But where does that money come from? And that's a problem. So for the United States to go over and say, hey, we are behind you 100%, but you need to start paying your fair share, it's not a surprise. And behind the doors, it's what all the leaders have been talking about. They understand. If you go back to the European Union's effort to create a European army, they realize that there's a shortfall. And I was just reading an article that was part of this Munich summit that is going on right now. I think it came out yesterday. It talked about Europe's inefficient defense spending. And I wish I had seen it sooner. I would have put it into this briefing because the chart showed something like main battle tanks. So in Europe, they buy 17 different main battle tanks within Europe, NATO Europe. The US buys one. And we haven't produced a main battle tank in, I think, close to 20 years, maybe even more than that. We've been using the M1 since Desert Storm in 1990. We just modify it and we improve it. And within Europe, if they're spending that much on that many different pieces of equipment, there's a lot of inefficiency there. So I think, you know, one of the things that if we continue our commitment to NATO, we work hard to maintain it, there could still be a shakeup on the financial side where we say, look, you have to start improving the way that you spend on defense. How that's going to happen, I don't know. But for the Europeans, it's a big issue. And so you'll see, it's going to be interesting to hear what Angela Merkel says tomorrow in her, but I'm sure that it's going to be something that reinforces moderation, that reinforces support, and reinforces that European countries will do what they can to get to that point from a perspective that it is a challenge. It's not something that's going to happen overnight. I think that that's something that we don't talk about either, is that these efforts are slow going to get to that point. It's just, I think right now, the US wants it done faster. So Russia, where do we stand with Russia? Where does Europe stand with Russia? Europe has a completely different relationship with Russia than we do. We have very little trade. We have very little military to military contact, almost none. And we just have not had a need to foster a relationship. And we've largely ignored it for the last 20 years. It just hasn't been something that has been a priority for us. You know, come to Ukraine, it suddenly becomes, why are we ignoring this problem? And so from a European perspective, you know, we cite it as one of the 4+1 threats. Secretary Mattis, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs, General Dunford, Chief of Staff of the Army, we all recognize this 4+1 concept, North Korea, Iran, China, Russia, and terrorism. Those are the five major threats that the United States, the military establishment, views as our threats. So despite what the president says about Russia, there is still a perception on the defense side, which I think is respected by the president, that Russia is in there as one of the threats or one of the adversaries that we have. Now, in Europe, they have the challenge, okay, this is one of our large trade partners. We get most of our oil and gas imports from Russia. How do we deal with Russia? Now, if you look at what's happened in Ukraine, I'm starting to probably get into my security slides a little bit. It's Europe that's in Ukraine. It's not the U.S. I mean, how much have you really heard about U.S. intervention in Ukraine since 2014? And I'm not talking military intervention. I'm talking political. There's not been much. It's been primarily the OSCE, the EU, and our European allies that have been trying to handle the crisis in Ukraine. And that's because it matters to them. It matters a lot more than it does for us. Our problem would be NATO expansion down the road, which we have not really pushed since the annexation of Crimea. Well, the EU is still continuing its work with Ukraine to bring it into the European Union. So there's still efforts that are going on to get them to bring their country closer in line with the requirements of the European Union. And so far, Ukraine seems to be making those efforts. But where does that leave the military conflict? So one of the things that Russia is believed to be doing through their efforts in Ukraine is fracturing the EU, fracturing NATO, driving wedges. Now, I think that if you look at the people within certain countries that are supporting the Russians or saying that maybe life was better under Moscow back during the Soviet Union, I think those numbers are low. But at the same time, those numbers are growing. And those numbers are being heard more and more in certain countries. And at the same time, it's having the opposite effect that life wasn't so good under Moscow. It's just that you over in Western Europe, you don't realize it. You don't realize how worried we are about falling back under that system. So there's a lot of what's going on within EU. And to some degree, I think that Vladimir Putin is enjoying that within NATO, that little conversation of, you know, are you going to be there to support me in the Baltics if Russia comes in? It's a conversation that is being had over there that has some countries worried. Has them worried of Russian aggression, but it also has them worried about maybe Russia's actions. We have accusations of Russian involvement in our elections. Well, they have the same thing over there, only probably to a greater degree and in a more open way, because Russia has been involved with these countries in different ways than they are involved with us. And then Turkey. You wonder, why is Turkey up there? Turkey has always been one of my favorite countries to study. Turkey, in my opinion, is the country of great potential. It's a huge market. The European Union, in my opinion, should have brought them in a lot sooner. I understand the Greek opposition to it, but there was a time when the Greeks had enough and said, okay, Europe, if you really think Turkey should be part of the EU, then go ahead and let them in. And Europe said no. And they said, not quite ready for a Muslim country to enter the European Union. So this issue of Turkey, what is Turkey doing? You know, we've seen a change in Turkey in the last 8 years. Turkey was an incredibly important country based on its location. It's a country that has one of the largest land armies. I believe it's the second largest land army after the United States in NATO. It's got one of the best equipped. They've spent billions on equipment, not just US equipment, but German equipment. So they have some of the best main battle tanks that are deployed in the world. They have some of the best attack helicopters, F-16s, all the best equipment that we have to offer, Turkey has. And they have experience. They've been fighting a war since the early 70s against the terrorist group in southeastern Turkey, the PKK, Kurds. And that's important when we talk about Turkey, because our efforts to involve the Kurds in Syria is not really something that's welcomed by Turkey. It's not something that they really embrace to have us training and equipping Kurds who they fear, once they're done in Syria, are going to head back out to Kurdistan, just on the other side of the Turkish border, and start fighting their army out there in the east. So Turkey has its own concerns there, but at the same time, it has influence. And Prime Minister Erdogan, he understands that today. I think he has become quite adept at using that to his advantage. So all the way back to 2003, when the U.S. wanted to use Turkey as a corridor to get into northern Iraq, and they said no, I think you started to see a shift in policy. A secular democracy, a country where the Constitution reigned supreme, secularism was incorporated into all forms of government, into the military. But as with all things that are an extreme, that began to change. So my first visit to Turkey in 1997, I met some officers from the Turkish War Academy. Some were practicing Muslims, some were not. The ones that were practicing were not supposed to be seen going to mosque. If they were seen going to mosque, they could get in trouble. That's probably a little bit too far to one extreme. And eventually that's going to change because you can't just keep all of them from exercising their religious freedom, even if they do take an oath to a secular constitution. Their individual freedom should allow that. So as Erdogan comes in as an Islamist and brings in some of his changes, starts to change the judiciary, which in Turkey has been used in the past for non-military coups to remove Islamists in the past, started changing out the general officers. Those that were secularists were replaced, retired, or charged with some kind of a crime and removed. So you see a transition in the military towards Islam. You see the government starting to change, and now Erdogan would like to change the constitution so he can remain in power for another 10 or 20 years. So there are changes there going on internally that concern Europe, concern us as well, as they move forward. The changing relationship between Turkey and Russia. Just a couple of years ago when they shot down a Russian fighter plane, we thought that they might have to invoke Article 5 of the NATO treaty and ask for defense of Europe against the Russians because the Russians were really angry that they had shot down one of their planes and killed one of their people. So we go from that to suddenly now working with Russia, working with Iran to try to find a resolution for the issues in Syria. And so where does that leave the West? Where does that leave Europe in relations to Turkey? Well, then come up to 2016 and we have the migration crisis. And we have refugees stranded in Greece. We have illegal refugees just flowing across. Videos on YouTube of the Turkish Navy escorting refugee boats across the Aegean until they get safely into Greek territorial waters. Whether those are legal or illegal, I don't know. But the point is, a lot of migration, most of it coming through Turkey into Europe. So the European Union gets this solution. Well, let's offer Turkey some incentives to prevent that from happening. And I am definitely getting ahead now because I have some slides on this. But the issue there is it is what the European Union did to influence Turkey, is it legal? Was it legal within the laws of the European Union? And was it legal within the international laws that we've agreed to through treaties with the United Nations? Some human rights organizations would say that Turkey is not a safe third party, a third country to return people to. And that's part of the law. And Greece, even though it does not want the large number of refugees that it has, Greek courts have determined that they cannot return some of these refugees to Turkey because it is not a safe place. So Turkey's a conundrum for Europe right now, and we've got to find a way to keep it oriented towards the West instead of oriented towards the East. And then the last problem with it is that it is the southeastern anchor, which was critical during the Cold War against Russia. And so what happens if Turkey suddenly decreases the value of its relationship with NATO and increases it with Russia or some other entity out towards the east that may not be so friendly with us? So what happens there? And for the European Union, the effects on them, because like I said, the market there and Turkish residents of Europe now, specifically in Germany. Okay, and then the unresolved issues. I kind of touched on Cyprus a little bit. Cyprus being divided since 1974. Right now, the leaders of both sides, the Greek side and the Turkish side, are from the same town in southern Cyprus. So there's a lot of optimism that these two gentlemen are going to be able to resolve the issue. But at the same time, Greece is the big brother for the southern half, and Turkey for the big brother for the northern half will have none of it. There's got to be certain points that those two countries find acceptable before the people who actually live there can make an agreement. It's been frozen in conflict now for 40 years. And if you ever go to the northern side of Cyprus, you can see a marked difference from the southern side. The southern side, which is part of the European Union. And that's a bit of a problem for them. The other one is Macedonia, the name issue with Macedonia. This has been an ongoing problem since Macedonia got its independence. It's a political issue between Greece and Macedonia that nobody in the West seems to be able to get past. Now, I love the Greeks. I love Greek food. I have great Greek friends. I would go back to Greece this year if I had a job and could live there. But this issue is one that's got to have compromise. There's got to be some way that European institutions can find a way to bridge this. And there's been lots of solutions to people outside of those two countries that have been offered, that have been put out there. But for one reason or another, there's a small issue that's been deemed unacceptable by the other side. But Macedonia, if you notice back in that first chart, they're still members of Partnership for Peace. They're outside of the European Union. They are not part of the club. Although they're very important because it's a route into the Balkans from the port of Thessaloniki. And Michael, that's how you pronounce it, by the way. And it is a route that is important to us. It's a country that's important. When I say us, I reference Europe as well. And it's important to get that country into its membership into NATO and the European Union. So that we have these two issues. Now, the reason I put them up there is because I link them to the issues in Crimea, the issues in Ukraine. We haven't solved those two issues in the last 40 years. How are we going to solve an issue with Russia in eastern Ukraine that's not a member of the European Union, not a member of NATO? How are we going to do that? And for those that look at this problem, there can be multiple solutions, but in the end, it'll come down to, do we get it back? Does Ukraine get it back, or does Russia keep it? And so that's a complex question that I'm not going to tell you one way or the other what's going to happen with it. But if I were a betting man, I would say Russia is not going to give up Crimea. I don't think they're going to give it up anytime soon. And in fact, if ever, with the Russian Black Sea Fleet based in Crimea, with the Russian minorities that live there, and their claim for historical ties, I really don't see it. So maybe there's a way they're going to have to look at diplomatically finding a solution that may not be the best for the people of Ukraine, but it's going to be the way forward. Otherwise, this is going to be a frozen conflict where we're going to be talking for decades about what's going to happen. So we'll see, because everything is evolutionary. I mean, I think that as we look at what's happened with Europe, even here in the United States, it's an evolution. It's not, if you try to make some of these changes overnight, you're going to find resistance. I think that's a lot of the resistance that we've seen for those folks that elected President Trump, for people in Europe. I think that some of the changes that we're going through and that Europe is going through are happening a little too fast for some people. And it's not just some people, it's large minorities or large numbers of people within these populations. And in some cases, it is relatively the whole population that feels that way. But if it's a small country, we kind of ignore it, say, okay, well, that's just that country. But you can't just ignore some of those things. So I truly believe that change is important, that we have to get better at a lot of different things. But I also believe that some of these changes, we have to let them happen over time. And eventually we'll see that they do happen. So let's go on to those, we'll go back to those top four again. So I want to talk a little bit. I've talked about the geopolitical crises, I think, but let's talk about the migration issue before we get to some of the others, because the migration issue, in my opinion, is one of the most divisive right now. It's the one that, in my opinion, is what the right-wing parties are able to use to really threaten the European Union. And the right-wing parties in Europe, they are very anti-European integration. So they'll tell you right out that if I'm elected, I will vote to get out of the European Union. Brexit reinforced that for them, that it's possible for a country to say, hey, we don't agree with everything, we're going to move on. There's also the elections in the United States kind of reinforce that. But I think that what you find is that the election in the United States, depending on where it goes, by the time some of these elections, where the administration goes in the next few months, are going to drive some of these elections. Because what Europe is seeing on the news may not necessarily, and I would say mostly, is not necessarily good. And so people will look at that and say, well, what's happening in the U.S.? Is it good or bad? Isn't that going to be good or bad for us? So I think that you'll see some of that. But this migration issue, if you look at this chart here, from 2014 to 2015, there's an exponential increase in the number of asylum cases. I'm going to use asylum in some of these slides because refugee numbers are, well, actually all demographic numbers in Europe are hard to ascertain. It's just part of their system. The way that they do accounting of people is not necessarily, when you look for demographers, it's not the easiest thing to account for. So they find ways that they can do it. And this one here is one, asylum seekers. Because it's important, when you talk about migration, you have migrants, and that can be everybody, but generally speaking, a migrant is somebody who's looking for a better life. Someone who may be looking to find a job somewhere, relocate to another country, become a citizen there, become an expatriate, whatever it might be. But a migrant is someone who's moving on for a specific purpose that they want to a change in their life. A refugee is someone who leaves because of conflict, threat of death, persecution, that type of thing. A refugee moves to another place, usually temporarily. Now, temporarily can be many years in some cases. So like in Syria, it's going to be a long time before many of these refugees can be able to return back home. So in 2015, where you have over 1 million refugees coming into Europe, kind of strains the system, a system that wasn't necessarily prepared for it. Now, the asylum cases are those people from the refugee population that want to settle in the country that they are being hosted in, or the country that they've chosen for their asylum. So that number spiked, and that's kind of the one that we can judge by because it's the applications come in and we can take a look at those. This year, I know it's very hard to see, but this is 2016. So early 2016, you had over 100,000 each month up until October. So 100,000 people a month applying. Some of them may have been reapplications for ones that were rejected, but right around here in March, April is when the EU and Turkey came into their agreement. And that's when they agreed upon keeping the refugees in Turkey, trying to prevent the flow of illegal migration. This year, those are the months of 2016, starting January, every other month. So January, February, April, June, and so on, till the end. And you can see it taper off. Now, the reason I put this up there was because of Hungary. So we have Hungary right here. Hungary has been one of the most vocal about the issue of refugees. And they've been the ones that really have said, we can't do this. Some other countries, but Hungary, one, we're blocking the border. We're not allowing them in. We're going to have a referendum, and we're going to reject whatever the EU says about our quota. So when you look at the numbers around 1.3 million claims for asylum in 2015, 2016, those numbers were down significantly. Part of it was the agreement with Turkey. Part of it was some migration changes and some flows going more to the south and west as opposed to north and west. But what does it all mean? Because this is a refugee camp in Jordan. It houses almost 70,000 refugees. 70,000 refugees. This is a refugee camp, a new one, built after the 2016 agreement in Turkey. Now, these are pretty much provided by NGOs, supported by NGOs. Now, I'm working up a little bit. So when we see these, this one here, let's see if it comes in. This is the newest camp in Turkey, containerized housing. Probably has ablutions with showers and toilets and that type of thing. They provide food. And in fact, the EU in this one adopted something that the International Red Cross had implemented, which was the use of debit cards. So they've given out a certain number, I think it's like around 10,000 debit cards. But the debit cards are not for money. The debit cards are for rations, for toiletries, things that people might need to live. And so that's the effort in Turkey. Now this one, this is one of the largest refugee camps in Greece. You see a difference between this one and what we see in Jordan and in Turkey? A lot of commercial tents, just probably donated by people. You do have the NGO buildings here where they probably cook and some shower facilities. But these tents extend up here beyond the borders of the camp. They're in the back over here. Conditions are not good there. Yet this is one of the largest. It's on the border with Macedonia, Idomeni. And it's one of the places where those that are prevented from continuing north into Macedonia or into the Balkans remain here. Now, initially, there was no problem with this. The Greeks were actually very welcoming. The local villagers were helpful. But things started happening as the longer people stayed here. Bad things. So they'd start, the residents of the villages would notice that clothes were missing from their clothesline or something was missing from their yard. And then people started finding people in their houses, in their kitchens. And that's when the Greeks started saying, whoa, this is getting a little bit too much for us. The EU, while supporting some of this, really wasn't reacting very fast to it all. This is another camp that was built on the island of Lesvos. It's a former military detention center taken over by an NGO. You can see down here that they put a nice new barbed wire fence, you know, with the concertina along the top. Some would say is a prison. Now it's a temporary facility or a temporary location because Lesvos is one of the main, it's one of the closest islands to Turkey, and it's where a lot of the immigrants come from. And so they bring them here and they actually process. They're there to process. It holds about 3,000. And they bring them there to process them before they go on to Europe. And what they've started to do is they started early on. I have a good friend who works for Immigration and Customs Enforcement here in the U.S. His trips to Greece have probably tripled in the last couple of years. When I lived in Greece in 2011, they came to visit, his family came to visit, but I don't know if he had been there. I don't think he had been there on an official visit, even though we were trying to work with the Greeks on border control and biometric data and accounting for people coming in and out. But it wasn't until this crisis, probably around 2013, where it really started taking off. And he was literally just there last month. And so there's a lot more cooperation with them that we're doing. But at the same time, the European Union has to confront this. And the European Union has to find ways to deal with it. So they have this organization called Frontex that helps, that does take care of it and does a lot of work. But there's also now an effort to increase surveillance and reporting, consolidating those efforts so that there's a better way. And then the last one I'll put up there is one of the newest camps, which is in Tempelhof Airport. And it's a facility in seven hangars, abandoned hangars, that the Germans created that houses about 7,000 people. It's in Berlin. Berlin has about 30,000 refugees. So the question is, where's the other 23,000? And you can look online, you'll find pictures of people living under bridges, living in near the port facilities, outside of airports, in places where generally they can try to find a way to jump on a train or something else. Now, Germany is the destination for a lot of the refugees. A lot of them have family there, or they know that the German system is very welcoming, so they try to get there. They're not trying to get out. But you can see that even Germany, probably the wealthiest country in Europe, is having a hard time figuring out, how do we deal with these refugees? And when we talk about the numbers may be relatively small compared to their populations, but the reality is, where are they housed? Where do we, okay, so if Hungary gets just under 1,300 refugees based on the quota, which they had already taken probably 10 times, not 10 times that, but they, well, yeah, they've taken at least 10 times that, maybe 20 times that through their own system. But they have this 1,270 people. Where do they all go? And if you keep them all in that little tent city that you see in Greece, and life is not good there, what do you expect from that refugee group? So at the bottom of this, what I would say is that there needs to be a greater effort within the European Union to find a way to deal with this. One where it's leveraging its money. This here is just a recapping the applications for asylum for each of those. This is the quota right here. So when you come down to the, you know, Hungary, it's not very many. It's about 1,300. And so a lot of these countries are not required to under that quota system. But you know, it's important to note that Hungary had a, I don't know if I have a slide on this or not, Hungary, when they had a referendum, and the referendum was whether to accept this European quota of 1,300 refugees or not. Now, they do have a right-wing government in Hungary. And the question was, do we accept them or not? Well, 92% of the voters said, we will not accept those 1,300 refugees. But it was 92% of 47% of the electorate that voted. So without breaking the 50% threshold, the referendum went nowhere. But the pictures that came out in Europe and in the United States, CNN carried this picture, and it's a great cultural picture of three women coming out of the polling booths, obviously staged because they all have their left hand up holding the curtain open, coming out smiling, in traditional cultural costumes that represent those people in Hungary that are against the refugees coming in. Very, very, to me, a meaningful picture because it depicts those people that are against it. 92% of those voters that came out said no to that, to 1,270 people. To me, that was telling. And this year, I put this up because foreign-born population in Europe. So this is a couple years old, and it's probably not much more. You can see it hovers at 7%. You know, maybe with the migration in 2015 and 2016, it's a little bit more. But that's not a very big number. So 7% of the population, if integrated, assimilated, and spread out through the community, why is it a problem? And I'll leave that for you to think about because we need to move on. The euro crisis. So Dr. Moravchik said that the euro crisis is the one that's the hardest for the EU to solve. I lived in Greece when the euro crisis struck. I saw good people have their pensions slashed. I saw the way that Greece was treated by the rest of the European Union. I don't fault the Germans for their perception, because there are some societal issues within Greece that cause that. But there are also functional issues with the system, where the monetary system is controlled by the European Union and the fiscal system is controlled at the states. There's got to be ways that you address that. There's got to be a better functioning. Now, states don't want to give up sovereignty. I understand that. And I know I can stand here in Carlisle, Pennsylvania, and simplify the issue. that a lot of smart people in Brussels are trying to solve. But at the same time, I mean, when you look at this up here, that's not what I wanted to do. Okay, maybe, can you fix that back there, Matt? So if you look at the top up there, that one here, these are the demonstrations that have been ongoing in Greece since, well, they always have demonstrations, they find a reason, but specifically to the Euro crisis, because I knew police officers whose, in the 2 years I was there, their monthly salaries went from around 1,800 euros, so maybe $2,200, $2,300 a month as a senior police officer, someone with maybe 18 years in, to about 1,400 euros a month. So these police officers that I knew, they had to get second jobs because they couldn't support their families based on the cuts. Because when you impose austerity, the easiest ones to impact are the ones that the government controls, whose paychecks they control. And the people that worked in the embassy for me, because we were fair reporters of their income, they were hurting. Because as we continued to report their income, the Greek government increased the taxes on them. So you have austerity cutting local employees, you have taxes going up, but that's the measure based on a system where the monetary and fiscal policies are separate. That's the system that the European Union, in addition to the loans that they give, but that's the system that the government has to abide by. Now, other institutional problems with the government, a lot of publicly owned industries. Hellenic Aerospace was kind of a Lockheed Martin kind of a company owned by the government. The trains, the telephones, no one used their landline telephone because it was terrible. Yet it's owned by the government. A lot of people on the government rolls being paid that have been dead for years, but somebody's still collecting their money. A lack of automation, in my opinion, is huge because taxation for individuals is a hard thing to come by. If you have someone come into your house, to a plumber come in, many times, and this was a few years ago, hopefully it started to change, but the plumber would say, do you want a receipt or do you not want a receipt? And I, as an unknowing American, say, well, what's the difference? Well, if you want a receipt, I have to charge you taxes. If you don't want a receipt, I'm not going to charge you taxes. It's like, okay, I won't answer the rest of it. But you know, the European Union response initially was lukewarm. In fact, I think it was President Obama who finally told the European Union, you have got to do something about this. This is going to be a problem. And so their response, it could have been stronger initially. Instead of blaming the Greeks, find a solution. Because as you see, there's other problems. And we still have those problems that were laid out that are in other countries. And if we have an issue, now Greece's economy is a small part of the European Union. But if you have a country like Italy that continues to have problems, and Italy's economy then suddenly requires the same kind of attention that the Greek economy did, that's a problem. Because Italy does have a manufacturing base. They do have a large economy relative to the European Union. So what happens? And that's something that the European Union needs to be concerned about. Now, on the other hand, I think the European Union, and he gets into this in the article, they do need to stand up and recognize the power they have. The US, China, and the EU are the big three. And the European Union may be slightly ahead of everybody. I mean, if you look at this chart here, it's kind of interesting. It talks about global power, and it's got three elements to it. It's got economic, it's got soft power, and it's got military. So it's, and based on this institute in Spain that does these calculations, they say that the European Union has about 38% of the economic power in the world. And they say militarily it's about 15%. And then about 45% is soft power. So it's strength. They've got a lot of strength in its soft power and its economic power. So the European Union, they needs to, and I think this is where they're going with their having a military, strengthening the military arm, is that the European Union needs to realize that it is a powerful player in the United States. It's an important player, and I need to say, in the world. Not just in Europe, not with the U.S., but it's a key player globally. If you look at the GDPs, the EU's is, when you look at all countries combined. Now, we had Dr. Andy Wolf from Dickinson College talk to us a few weeks back. And he put up an interesting slide that I will give him credit for, that I know he took from somewhere else. But I think that it's really a good chart because it shows, okay, the European Union in exports and in imports, pretty large. What it also shows, though, is the UK and shows Canada. I mean, it shows other countries that are part of the European Union. The importance, I think, and if it showed Germany and it showed some of the other countries, to see what these countries have individually as their own GDP, as a percentage of the European Union, they have pretty strong economies. Now, growth has been kind of weak, which interestingly, growth in the western part of Europe has been around 2% or less. In the eastern part, it's been 2 to 3%, a little bit higher. But these are strong economies. Now, some people say, well, then why are they going to have a problem if they were to separate from the European Union? There's a lot of opportunity from the European Union in terms of efficiency that are gained by not having to run your own trade agreements to coordinate different things related to the economy. There's a lot of efficiencies that if these countries had to do it themselves, would decrease probably the amount of GDP that they have because they have to commit so many more resources. This is employment. So this line here is the US. This is the Euro zone, Euro area being the Eurozone. You can see that employment it dropped, but it's kind of come back a little bit, just like in the U.S. Did not have as steep a drop. But I think, you know, what's interesting is their labor participation rate has remained relatively the same, maybe a little bit of an increase, dip down, whereas the U.S. labor participation rate has dropped. And that's important because that's the number of people not working. Anyway, so they've got a pretty good number of people that are still in the workforce. And when they calculate their employment numbers, it's based on actual people that are in the workforce. So the other part of this is the youth unemployment, which is not reflected here, which in Europe is really high. So in Greece, some of the estimates put youth unemployment at somewhere around 50%. So the younger people are not working. And that's a problem, because where are they what's going to happen to them? It's kind of pushed migration and some other issues. All right, I'm going to try to go quickly through these because I've been talking a lot longer than I should have. But democratic governance, this was one of the big issues that that the article brings up. And I agree that it is a big issue, but I don't think it's as big an issue as it should be made out to be. So Austria had an election where the right-wing anti-EU candidate was ahead. They went to an election. He actually lost by half a percentage point. The initial election, they had a runoff between the two top finalists. He wound up losing by half a percentage point. Six months later or so, they do the final election against the two candidates, and the Green Party candidate wins substantially. And that was kind of indicative of things there, because what's interesting, unlike here in the United States, the map of Austria was colored completely for the right-wing candidate, except for Vienna and other urban populations where the density of people, the population was higher. So with the popular vote, the Green Party candidate won, although he did not win the nation. And so that has some implications for the future, because if the rest of, as they go to regional elections and they start to have parliamentary elections, you know, how are the areas outside of the city is going to vote, and what's that going to do for the party. But it was the first time since World War II that one of the two centrist parties was not elected to be the president of Austria. So we had two fringe candidates, and nobody from the center parties was elected. Now, I bring that up partly to contrast it with what happened in the US, but also to talk about France. So everybody talks about Marine Le Pen and so how far ahead she is in the polls. She is way ahead in the polls. But with her, what will happen is she won't reach the 50% threshold, which means the top two candidates will have to vie for competition. And they are predicting that in a runoff between the top two, she will lose in a landslide. Now, I said at the beginning, you know, I put Johnny Carson up there, put Karnak up there. You know, predictions are not always right. Polls are not always right. But right now, in France, it appears that in the runoff, unless she meets that 50%, which she would have to gain a lot more votes, probably about 20% more votes to get to that 50% threshold, more than likely a right-wing party is not going to be elected. There are concerns in the Netherlands, but in the Netherlands, the right-wing party, they expect him to win. The right-wing, anti-EU candidate, Geert Wilders, who wants to pull out of the EU, follow the Brexit, he will probably win. But the problem is that there's no other party in that government that will form a coalition government with him. So what does that mean for Netherlands in terms of having a leader that can't form a government? So while governance is an issue and nationalism is an issue, I think when the elections are said and done, the national elections I don't think are going to be a problem. Regional issues will, and I'll go back to what I said earlier, that when a large part of your population believes one thing, you can't ignore that. You've got to. We've had so much polarization in the world right now, in Europe and in the US over political parties, that we've got to get back into where we're able to compromise with each other. Because what even in Germany, the local elections are showing that there's more conservative right-wing kind of candidates being elected. So you can't, in order to govern, you're going to have to find compromise. And that's what I find. So here's the picture. I guess I did put it in there. That's the picture of the voting in Hungary. All right, security. I'm going to go through this quick. NATO. NATO has expanded. It's grown. NATO, the most successful military alliance in history. Some people say not really. Some people say absolutely. And I'll leave that to you. It has helped prevent a war in Europe since World War II. It has been able to do out-of-area operations in Afghanistan and other places. And it's gotten 28 countries together to talk about issues. So it is a very effective alliance. And it has helped keep Europe whole and free for the last 70 years. But the question is, evolution of US policy regarding NATO. So the president said, NATO is obsolete during the campaign. But as a president-elect, it became important to him. And now he's been quoted as saying, we strongly support NATO. Okay? That's evolution of a politician. Put anybody in there. You know, I mean, that's the way it goes. But the thing is that what he's shown in his first meeting at the Pentagon is that he seems to trust Secretary Mattis with some decisions. And maybe this will become the way he governs, is that, and one of the big issues was torture. And when after his first meeting with Secretary Mattis at the Pentagon, he came back and said, well, I'll leave that to General Mattis to decide. If he thinks it's not something that we should do, then we won't. We study presidential decision making. And, you know, it could be the first time that we have a real bureaucratic model in a long time where the president actually trusts the cabinet members to provide input. Because a lot of times it's the president that drives the decision and maybe the close people around him, not necessarily the cabinet. So even in Obama's administration early on, when the cabinet tried to, when he didn't like what the cabinet was saying, he circled the wagons with certain advisors that informed him of what they thought policy should be. So maybe that's just a different change in presidential leadership. We'll see what happens. But today, I think definitively, you see, because even Secretary of State has said, NATO is important to us. And I think as long as we continue to say NATO is important to us, it will be important. When we stop saying it, that's when you got to worry about it. EU and OSCE, I talked about EU already, but OSCE does a lot of non-military things. The EU does, or the OSCE is involved in different places, but they do things like, they talk about economics, they help foster. The OSCE is very heavily into Ukraine right now. Some post-conflict locations like Bosnia, they're there trying to help build institutions. They are not necessarily military, but they're helping build the security in these places through other means. And I think that I talked enough about Ukraine and Baltics I touched on in terms of the concerns that they have with Russia and whether or not NATO will come to its aid. It's only about 120 miles from the Russian border to the Baltic Sea when you cross through the Baltics. A fast-moving armor column can do that very quickly. So the question in the mind of the Baltics is how quickly can NATO react? The question in my mind is how fast can the NATO bureaucracy decide under Article 5 to act? And hopefully they're thinking about that, because there's a lot of things that happen that we don't know about, that maybe there's decisions, that type of thing, I don't know. But you know, the decision to send an armored brigade combat team to the Baltics to support exercises and those types of things, and Poland, is because of that very recognition of that issue that if Russia ever decides to cross the border and move to Kaliningrad on the Baltic coast, which is Russian territory, there's very little way that we can stop it. And that's why the Baltics are worried. Something that NATO is acutely aware of and is taking action on, and I'm sure that there is planning going on that we don't know about. Okay, I'm going to skip this one. This is about OSCE. NATO expansion to the east. I put this one up here because, you know, you have the NATO expansion. You got Belarus and Ukraine, Russia up here. And so you get, you know, growing over time, heading further east. And then you have the European Union growing to the east. But I would ask, or is it encroachment from the west? So does Russia have, I mean, do they have a legitimate argument when they say, hey, you know, you're starting to circle us. You're starting to move, box us in. Go back to that first slide. Uzbekistan, Kazakhstan, Tajikistan, they're all over down on this side. So if the EU is moving this way, Europe is moving that way, does Russia have a legitimate concern? Is it something that we should be sitting down with Russia and saying, hey, you know, we want to do this in a way that is good for everybody? So here's some conclusions. You know, the EU, I believe, is a powerful global actor. And I think they recognize that. I think they're trying to improve that. I think that they should continue to evolve to face these challenges, but I think they need to do better at projecting or forecasting potential crises before they happen, because they've been slow to react. I think that the development of their foreign security policy will help in that regard. But they really do need to get better and watch those situations. And instead of sitting back as an economic crisis evolves, and waiting a year before they respond, thinking, okay, it's a one-off anomaly, take care of that problem. The same thing with military crises or other crises. There's got to be a plan. The other part, I think that the European Union will not disintegrate. Europe will not disintegrate. They've come out of many challenges in their history, and they always come out a bit stronger. As long as they don't give up and everything falls apart. I was at a conference in December at Tufts University where one of the speakers proposed that potentially the European Union could consolidate down just to a handful of northern countries. There's a lot of people that disagreed with that, but that potential's there. What does that mean for Europe? What does that mean for the European Union? Divide between north-south, the divide between east-west? Does that mean failure of the whole European experiment? I don't know, but I do believe that whatever they do, they're going to come out stronger on the other end. They're going to institute policies. Now, the policies that they have to help nations respond to economic crisis are pretty strong. They're really pretty good. The question will be, well, how do they implement those? How fast do they react? And I think that's where...
Okay. So NATO, either that or it's time for me to stop talking. So, okay, so NATO-EU cooperation. This is where, and I'm going to end it on this, that NATO-EU cooperation, I think, really needs to continue to grow together. I think there needs to be a serious consideration between inside of both organizations to see how, and I'm going to say it, and I've been debating whether to say it the whole week because it's, but I think that eventually NATO needs to become part of the European Union in some way. NATO, while the most successful military alliance, I believe can be integrated into the European Union as an institution. It's not a government, it's an institution. So they can make rules and they can incorporate an organization like NATO while not excluding Canada and the United States, to maintain it as an alliance as it is, but make it stronger. So right now, the deputy commander, Deputy SACEUR, Supreme Allied Commander Europe, is designated to command EU operations if necessary. The NATO staff can be used to support EU operations if requested. We're already looking at some of that integration. But my question would be, down the road, 20 years, I'm not talking, I told you, evolution of institutions, not immediate change, but is there a way, how much inefficiency is there in that first chart where you can save money, you can plan better, you can do everything better as one organization instead of trying to figure out how does the EU do it without stepping on NATO's toes, how does NATO do it without stepping on the EU's toes? So I put that out there. Just as something to think about, because I think it's important. Europe, if you're going to have a Europe whole and free, you've got to have European organizations that are whole. I think that they have to be able to work together as under one single umbrella. And I think that down the road, 20, 30 years, that's kind of what we need to get to. But in the meantime, Europe will still be there. The food will still be good, the people will still be great, and the sites are going to be awesome to visit, and they're going to continue as a powerhouse economically, and they're going to continue to be a great ally for the United States, and hopefully we will continue to be a great ally for them. So thank you for listening to me for the last hour and 20 minutes. And
European regulatory climate, how is that going to be affected if more and more states drop out of the European Union, the Euro, you know, that apparently was a good thing, and that impacted their trade policy a great deal. So if states start to drop out, how does that regulatory climate change, and what impact do you foresee on the trade situation with Europe?
Okay, I think that what you're seeing right now, using Brexit as an example, the European Union has kept a very firm line that they're not going to change anything, that they're not going to enter into any special deals, that the European or the United Kingdom will be treated just like any other partner in trade. They will not get any access to any of the opportunities or any of the benefits of the European Union, and they said they're not going to waver from any of those regulations. So I don't foresee any change to their regulatory system. I think that they will, part of it is, I think in an effort to discourage other countries to look at exiting as an opportunity, they are holding a very strict line to that. But I think that they have to. If they're going to, one, look at expansion while they are contracting, there's gotta be continuity. Their rules have gotta be the same. And there's really no reason for them to change them. They entered into a discussion with the UK over what was the UK's issues over departing from the European Union. And the UK's requests were such that the European Union said, we're not going to change. We're not going to allow you to pick and choose pieces of our system that you like and pieces that you don't like. So you either take it or you leave it. And so that's eventually where they got to. I think that will continue.
When NATO is set up, I think the purpose was to stop an invasion from Russia in case that happened. What's the purpose of really all that military equipment and stuff now? I mean, what do you see as they're supposed to do with that army?
Well, you know, we don't have all the equipment that we used to have. So the alliance is not as big in resources as it used to be. So I don't think that that is so much of an issue. Is that what your question is? Okay, well, you know, at its heart is Article 5. Article 5, Defense of Europe, because there's no other organization that's going to do it. So there's still the commitment, there's still the planning, there's still everything associated with the NATO treaty is still in place. We are still committed to support them. What most people don't realize is that there's an Article 4 that goes with Article 5. Article 4 is when the North Atlantic Council gets together and they discuss whether or not they will invoke Article 5. Article 5 has only been invoked once in the history of NATO, and that was in defense of the United States on September 12, 2001. And that's when NATO started patrolling our airspace, sent people over here to do that, and started to assist us in our defense of the United States. So interestingly, it wasn't even in Europe where that defense was. Now, we have the out-of-area operations that NATO has agreed is in their interest to do. Now, as you know, in the article, they talk about not every country participates in military operations. It's usually a coalition of the willing, but at the same time, they all agree to it. And you know, I think that one of the huge benefits of NATO is bringing those countries together to actually sit down and talk. Sitting down to talk about what the issue is, and then coming to agreement in a way that the smallest NATO country has the same power as the biggest NATO country. So as a small NATO country, you could say, I don't agree with that. I do not. So if you're Latvia and NATO is making a decision and they put it up for a vote, they call it breaking silence. They put it up. If Latvia does not agree with it, Latvia does not support it, and they are very strongly against it, they will break silence and say, nope, we do not support this action. And it doesn't happen. Now, I'm sure there's lots of negotiation. There's more discussion. Breaking silence is not an easy thing. I don't know whether it's peer pressure or if it's just that people or the nations are just not really comfortable doing it. But it's rare that such a sensitive vote comes up, such as defense or action by NATO. And usually by the time it gets to a vote, there's been so much coordination in the halls of NATO headquarters that by the time it gets to a vote, everyone's pretty sure that all nations agree. But then whether or not they support that in terms of troop commitment and that type of thing is another issue. So I hope that helps understand it.
You said that we cannot predict the future, and I agree with you. So I'll ask for your opinion.
Okay. I like opinions. I have a lot of them.
In the last couple of years, the Scottish wanted to secede, and they had a referendum, and that failed. And in the last elections, Brexit, the English pretty much voted to exit, but the Scottish wanted to stay as part of the EU. So you think the Scottish would have at it again and exit UK? And will that make them a smaller nation state than they are today?
You know, in 2015, a very renowned scholar, I just watched this earlier this week after I read the article. I looked up a video, and this one scholar said there is 0% chance that the UK will leave the European Union, and that the UK, the people will vote yes to support a UK exit. So I will not say it's 0%, because Obviously, that's one of the examples of not being able to predict the future. But what I would say is that it's a huge issue right now, because the Scottish did not want to leave the EU, and it was a narrow margin that they decided to stay with within the UK. The problem is, I think if you look at Scotland, there, and you go back to your regulatory question, if you exit the United Kingdom, you lose a lot of benefits of being part of that group, a powerful group. You have to reestablish all kinds of international organizations, your own State Department, a lot of different elements of government in order to, you have to develop your trade relationships. There's a huge cost to leaving. It's not just a matter of there's gonna be a huge cost for the UK, and I'll predict that with the UK, there's gonna be a big drop in their economy before they get back on board with being a country operating outside of the EU. I think, again, I'm an optimist, so like the EU's future, I think that the UK will recover from it. But I don't think that Scotland's going to, and this is opinion, but I don't think that they will. I mean, there's a possibility because politically they don't agree with it, but I think part of it will also be to see what happens with the exit, with what happens with the European Union and the UK writ large in terms of that relationship. But there's a good likelihood that they will put up a referendum, and I think that there's a small chance that they will separate from the UK. But I personally don't think that will happen.
Thank you very much for your thoughts and insights. We do appreciate it. I'm going to do a two-parter, if I may.
Sure.
One, did the U.S. or does the U.S. have an obligation to defend the Ukraine under the existing either NATO or other agreements? And then second, separately, is you didn't talk a whole lot about the euro issue, which the writer did and seemed to suggest that's the big elephant in the room. Mm-hmm. Is that big enough to start pushing people away, or is it really other issues that might cause the breakup?
Okay.
Thank you.
Yeah. On the first one, the U.S. does not have an obligation. Ukraine is not a member of NATO. They're members of the Partnership for Peace program, but they're not signatories of the North Atlantic Treaty. So there is no treaty obligation to defend Europe, defend Ukraine. That's kind of, I think, why we stepped back in the last couple of years from the Ukraine issue. In fact, some of the criticisms from the European Union is that the U.S. stepped back completely from Ukraine. And in the absence of the U.S., the EU and the OSCE have intervened and tried to support Ukraine in its efforts. The second part of the question, the euro. There's a lot of, when the euro crisis began, there was a lot of concern that the euro would go down with Greece, with Ireland, with Italy. They were all gonna collapse, and that was gonna bring down the euro. And that was right after we had our economic crisis start in 2008, and Europeans were saying, well, the euro is now potentially gonna be the new currency for the world because we are stable and strong. I think part of it, that goes to show that the fluctuations in currencies is something that is gonna happen regardless of whether or not you have these crises. I think that countries will be more reluctant to look at joining the euro. I think that the EU is gonna also be more critical of countries that want to join the eurozone. So when Greece joined the euro, my wife, being the non-economist that she is, she said, this was 8 years before the crisis, she said, and we had only lived in Greece 1 year, but she knew Greece well enough. She had gone shopping in the markets, and she is not an economist, by the way. But she said that there's no way that Greece is gonna be able to handle this currency. We were in Germany when the EU was instituted, or the euro was instituted, and in our little neck of the woods right there in Freihingen, Germany, outside of Patch Barracks, what the Germans did is they basically just converted the little DM for Deutschmark to an E for euro, and everything almost doubled in cost overnight. Because at the time, the exchange rate was about 2-1, and it was pegged to the dollar when it started. And so prices went up automatically overnight, in, or at least where we were. And then when Greece justified their entry, she said, there's no way. It's not a manufacturing country. It's service oriented. Entering the EU, they have quotas on olive oil, feta cheese, and citrus fruits, which are some of their biggest exports, or it had been. So they had to decrease what they were gaining as revenue in that way. There's just a lot of things against them. Not to mention that we kind of knew, even back in the late 90s, that most Greeks were not paying taxes. The government was providing all kinds of services, but gaining very little revenue. So, and spending a lot on defense. It's like, well, where's that money coming from? How are they paying for all of this? Then our crisis hits, and it has an effect on them. And suddenly, you know, the emperor has no clothes, and Greece's books are opened, and we find that, okay, well, maybe they weren't where they said they were, and maybe they're just not able to keep up the same way. So right now, I don't know if you know it, but most of the money that the Greeks get from the European Union and the IMF and so on goes to pay back European banks. Very little of it goes to the Greek government to support what they've got going on in their country. So they're trying to use their own national assets, but at the same time, the bailout money they're getting is going straight back to the European banks, because that's where the default was going to be. If Greece defaulted and couldn't pay back the major banks in Germany and France, it was going to have significant implications. So I think that the EU, that's a long way around the answer, but I think the EU really has to look at the country coming in. And they really need to ask them to open the books. Now, some of these countries have secret accounts that they maintain. They won't call them secret, but when you start to dig into it, it's like, wait, what's this over here for? Oh, don't, that's nothing. That's a, you know, we have it. We call it OCO. There are contingency funds that we use. You know, Department of Defense has its budget here, but here's the money that we, it's not secret, but we say, here's the money that we're going to use for contingency operations. And we keep it separate where we don't, and some of these countries don't actually say that they have this little fund. So they've got to open the books. The EU has to get them to open their books and say, full disclosure. Now, I'm sure that the Greeks did that. They said, here's our books. But I don't know if the European Union, in its zeal to gain more members back in the early 2000s, if they really looked as deeply as they should have, I don't know, I wasn't there. But in the end, it turns out that if they did, the Greeks did a pretty good job of not showing everything. So I think that's going to be the big thing for future members, is going to be whether or not they actually meet the standards required by the European Union. Oh, yes.
I also thank you for teaching us just exactly what the organization was, but I'm thinking in my head, how do they relate to the United Nations? Mm. I mean, this is a big world, and you see that on the news all the time, mm-hmm. and now there's another organization that's very yeah. vast and decisions made to be in it. How are they going to affect each other, and how will it affect America?
Yeah, the United Nations has a global responsibility. They to establish international norms, to give a voice to countries around the world to bring up issues, to discuss issues. You know, it may sound really nice to say, but you know, to promote peace, to promote discussion, to promote the rule of law and the global order, maintain some degree of order. The EU is just a piece of that. So the EU, really, when it comes to an international action, will very rarely take an international action without the UN Security Council making a decision. So if it's a security issue, the EU probably will not act on it. Same thing with NATO. Well, NATO will try to get a mandate. Most countries will not accept. If there's no United Nations mandate to do something, most countries will not do it. Whatever that requirement might be. But the other part of it, so like the UN, the Convention on the Law of the Sea, is one good example. So right now we are not signatories, but we abide by the UN Convention on the Law of the Sea, how we conduct ourselves out on the open seas, how we view territorial waters and so on. The EU has established, the United Nations has established this convention, created this convention through all the countries participating. The European Union endorses almost all of it. They're always a major player in developing it, just like we would be, or Russia or China. We develop the systems in the UN, these rules, and then we decide whether we're going to sign them or not. So the United Nations is very influential in what the United Nations does. It's a two-way street for them. They probably, I won't say do more in support of the United Nations, but they are more active in supporting UN resolutions and activities than we are. They believe in and this is a general statement, a global governance. They believe that there needs to be some kind of order that's established by the United Nations to keep all countries kind of in the same room, to promote dialogue, to promote commonality, that type of thing. So the EU is not in competition in any way with the United Nations. The EU, it's not subordinate to the United Nations. But decisions that come out of the United Nations most likely will be adopted by the European Union based on just historical evidence. So, does that answer it for you? Okay.
A question about cyber defense. Mm-hmm. Does NATO and the European Union do anything jointly in cyber defense, or is that up to each individual country to protect their own information technology assets that run the power grid and the communication networks and things like that?
Yes. No, I don't think there's an organization, government, anything that really ignores cyber anymore. In fact, for those that don't know, there's a NATO headquarters in Norfolk, Virginia, headed by a French four-star general with an international staff that supports him. It's called Allied Command Transformation. And we were fortunate enough to have their chief of staff here, a British three-star, back in January, who talked about his organization. And he put up the ongoing efforts that they have right now. And one of the major ones was cyber. And working with the European Union and member states. The other thing that you may not know is, well, this Allied Command Transformation, their job is basically to develop the future NATO. They look at what the threats are. They've got some of the best strategists. In fact, General Mattis mentioned this morning when he was in Munich about the importance of this headquarters, which has planners and strategists who are looking to the future and trying to see where NATO needs to go. The other thing that you may not know is that Estonia is a cyber center of excellence. I mean, it's a country that is really embraced cyber. And I was in Estonia last year, I think, maybe the year before. I was amazed. Every restaurant, every bar, the buses, Wi-Fi everywhere, very high tech. And it was free. It was all open and free. And they're known for their programming. They're known for their cyber defense. And it's a place that we, a small country, that we leverage their capability as an alliance to try to make the alliance better. So yes, cyber is definitely an area that NATO is looking at. It's definitely an area that the EU looks at beyond military. I mean, they'll look at it into the economic side, the banking side, all of that. But the nations also have, just with almost everything, they still have a responsibility internally to maintain certain defenses. There are very few countries that give up all of their sovereignty. There's no country that gives up all of their sovereignty to the UN, UN, EU, or NATO. And if they ignore the cyber challenge, then they're doing it at their own peril. And I think they all recognize that they have to have some capability themselves. And that some of them may rely more on NATO partners than others, or on EU partners, but there's still a degree in every country where they do it themselves.
We've discussed how NATO essentially is a defense force for the EU. Recently, actions around Karabakh, Germany, the airfield, a lot of action going on. The 4th Division forward, Baltic, Ukraine. Could you give us, or are you in a position to give us, an update of how the Army is doing moving forward in those in Europe? Might say changing the charter, the future of the United States military in Europe.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, the first thing, though, is to clarify that the NATO is not there for the defense of the EU. There are 22 countries that overlap in the two organizations. So there are 6 in the EU that are not NATO members. And then there are 6 in NATO that are not EU members. So they are distinctly different with distinctly different mandates. If the EU, this is where we get into that discussion over terminology. You know, NATO is there for the defense of Europe. Doesn't matter if you're an EU member. Technically, it's the defense of a NATO member, but you're de facto protected. So Montenegro, which is not a member yet, but is going through the process now where it's just waiting for, in our country, it's just waiting for Senate confirmation, as it is in many countries right now. It's already been approved for membership. But until it becomes a member, it's still under the protective umbrella because of how we would defend. But technically, they don't have a voice at NATO headquarters to say, can you come defend me because of your treaty obligation? So I hope that explains that a little bit. So theoretically, if NATO's protecting its members, it's protecting the EU. But technically, you know, Turkey is not a member of the EU. If they're defending Turkey, are they defending the EU, or are they defending Europe, NATO? So that's the first thing. The second part, right now, there's no real increase in permanent presence. And I don't know all the details of what's going on with the Army, but we do have the rotational force. And that's going to continue for the foreseeable future. What will be interesting to see how ballistic missile defense continues. It'll be interesting to see. And one of the things that President Trump has said is that he wants to decrease the nuclear arsenal. And he would like to do that with Russia, that bring those numbers down. It'll be interesting to see if that happens. I don't think, given the way that we are right now, until we've been authorized an increase in manpower within the Army, but with our efforts vis-a-vis Asia, it's going to be hard to say whether or not we are going to, and in the Middle East still, it's going to be hard to say whether we're going to increase a presence there. But I don't think that we're going to increase manpower. Now, we have a lot of equipment that's stationed in different places in case we need to fall in on it. And I would think that those plans are evolving right now, that U.S. Army Europe, along with the allies, is developing new plans to reinforce Germany, or Europe, not Germany anymore, it's all the way out through Poland. So, but I can't give you an exact answer because I don't know where we stand right now, but I don't think that the intent is to increase the number of units that are stationed over in Germany permanently. Or in Europe.
All right. Last question.
Thank you. Can you speak to the connection between NATO and the EU and Interpol?
You know, I really don't know much about Interpol. I do know that the EU works with Interpol through some of the things that they do in terms of their regulations and rules, but as far as NATO goes, I don't really know. I can't answer that.